Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. Welcome to Living Word. Good to be here. I'm Kevin. Thanks for having me this morning. Hopefully we'll sing a few familiar songs that you guys know.
Thank you, Father, that we can worship together. Lord, I ask this time would be profitable and beneficial for our praise to you and you speaking to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Take this time to say to somebody, welcome to Living Word. Glad you are in the house of God today. Thank you.
search the world. It couldn't fill me. Man's empty grave, treasures that fade are never enough. You came along, you put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in love. Yeah, oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Amen.
I'm not afraid. Show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. I was the God of the mountain, is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't buy me again. Yeah. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves. You turn graves into gardens. Turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. I love you, Lord. This reminds me Exodus chapter 12. And in Exodus chapter 12, what we find is the Israelites are getting ready for Passover. They've been told by God they're living in Egypt, and the plagues have been sent to Egypt and the Pharaoh, and God's final judgment, the angel of death, is going to go through the camp. And it says, this is what he told the Israelites. He said, I want you to take a lamb, a perfect, spotless lamb. He said, I want you to kill it. And he said, I want you to sprinkle the blood on the doorpost. And what they would do is they would prepare the lamb and take the blood with a hyssop brush, and they would paint the doorpost almost in a cross fashion with blood. And then they would go inside, and as the angel, it says that when the angel saw the blood, he would pass over them. And so the Israelites were safe, because when God's judgment saw the blood, he passed over them. They were safe and secure. In Genesis, after Adam and Eve had sinned, God told them, he says, I want you to take an animal. Well, actually, God did it, and he sacrificed an animal, spilled the blood of an animal, and covered them up, covered their sins. Fast forward to the New Testament. That's why we have Jesus. We have Jesus' blood, perfect, spotless lamb. And it says that when he sees the blood, when that blood is marked on our hearts, it says his judgment will pass over us. Yes. Thank Jesus for his blood. Amen. And that's what this song is about. It's about the clean, perfect, pure blood that covers us. And we're not going to be standing in front of God in his judgment, those who have given their life to Christ, and say, what have you done in this life that makes you think you deserve to be here? He's going to look at our hearts. He's going to see the blood of Jesus. Amen. He says, because of the blood, I will pass over your sin. Welcome in, my good and faithful servant, because of his blood.
Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Thank you very much. Let's bow our head in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and most of all, we thank you for the protection of your people, this great nation, from the hollers in the hills, from Tennessee. Be with the people down there in those tremendous floods, and there's been life lost, and we pray for those families. To our state, wonderful state of Michigan, all the people here, we bless this state and our nation, and help us. We just come to converse with you and in prayer, and we know you're there to listen to us. And the blood of the Lamb, which was sung here, has wiped us clean, and we thank you for that. And all our prayers, we think maybe are garbage, and we don't have the right words and colorful words to say to you. When it goes through the Holy Spirit, it arrives at you with you as wonderful, sweet music to your ears. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Kevin, and your daughter for leading us in worship today as Joey's away. I hope you guys will forgive me if I'm a little stiff up here. Decided it was time to start a workout program, and I might have hit it a little too hard at the gym this week. And, you know, I was bending, I was twisting, I was pushing, I was pulling, and my muscles got to the point they said, please, no more. And that was before I got out of the car, you know, so. Yeah, dad joke, I had to say it. It's always a little bit gut-wrenching for me to get up here and speak, and I always kind of struggle a little bit. I was talking to pastors this morning, and I just said, I don't know how he does it every week. You know, but we are thankful for him. And, you know, for me, like I said, it's kind of always a struggle. And if I'm struggling, I know you guys are struggling to sit up here and hear me speak. But in a way, it's, you know, because my talks, my messages are a little more like term papers than they are messages when I get up here. And they tend to be a little lengthy. But I have good news. Today will probably be my shortest message that I've ever given. Not because I necessarily planned it like that, but I got this note before I came up here today, and I'll just read it. It says, Mr. Brackens, I have a tea time at noon today, so please don't drone on and on like you normally do. If you know what's good for you, sincerely, your brother in Christ, Jason Davis. So, I guess that'll wrap it up. Anybody want to close? All right. Well, as I was thinking about what I wanted to talk about today, I was praying about it and, you know, just struggling with the whole idea of, you know, what am I going to speak about? A couple of verses came to mind. The first one was, the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of men. Amen. Yes. And the weakness of God is stronger than the strength of men. And then right after that, almost in the next breath, was from Matthew 11:25. I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and educated and have revealed them to the little children. And then I started to reflect on those things. And just to me, I kind of look back at the time when I was an agnostic person and thinking about these things and the connection of what that really meant. And I remember at that time, the Bible was a real stumbling block for me. You know, I believed that there was some greater power out there, but the Bible was a stumbling block for me. I mean, the stories, God's plan of salvation, it was all utter nonsense to me at the time. How could God use the most unlikely people and unlikely circumstances to carry out his will? So let's start in the Old Testament, and for time's sake, I will leave out some of the miraculous events and just focus a bit on the people. We'll talk about Noah. He lived in a time of great wickedness. Genesis 6:5 says that God looked into the hearts of men and seen that in every thought and every inclination was of evil. So distraught was he that later on it goes on to say that God regretted ever placing man on earth, leading to the total annihilation of life on earth, except for Noah and through him his immediate family. So after the Lord leads Noah and his family through this catastrophe, what does Noah do? Well, he plants a vineyard, he gets wasted, falls asleep naked in his tent for everybody to see. To me, that was, oh my gosh, what kind of person is this? Let's go further in Genesis. Abraham, God instructs Abraham to leave all that he knows, but he makes a covenant with him that he would make a great nation from him, and all his descendants would outnumber the very stars in the sky. So after having a personal encounter with the living God, what does he do? Well, on more than one occasion, he has his wife pretend that she is his sister and offers her up to the kings and pharaohs, fearing that they would kill him if they realized that he was her husband, which brought to some measure of dishonor to them upon Abraham, upon his wife, and ultimately God. Jacob insists, instead of trusting God to deliver on his promise, Jacob deceives, he schemes, he lies to his brother and his father and tries to steal the blessing that God has promised instead of waiting on God's time. Moses killed an Egyptian overseer, hid his body, and then fled Egypt to avoid justice. God then calls him back into Egypt, has a personal encounter again with a living God who instructs him to go back and lead his people out of Egypt. What does he do? He makes excuse after excuse after excuse of why he can't go. I could never do that. I'm nobody. Who would listen to me? Please, Lord, send somebody else. I could never do that. How will they know by whose authority is sending me? Please, Lord, send somebody else. I could never do that. None of the leaders will believe that you have sent me. Please, Lord, send somebody else. I could never do that. I am a horrible speaker, not gifted in speech. I would just freeze up and I would be horrified in front of Pharaoh. Please, Lord, send somebody else. So just to kind of recap some of that, Noah was a drunkard. Abraham was old and a liar. Sarah laughed at God's proclamation. Jacob was a deceiver and a liar. Moses had a speech impediment and was a murderer and filled with self-doubts. Gideon was a coward. Rahab was a prostitute. Samson was a womanizer and a covenant breaker. David was an adulterer and a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. And Jonah was borderline racist and ran from God. So far, as an outsider, looking at that on paper doesn't look very promising or inspirational. This is just a brief snapshot of the Old Testament. Let's jump into the New Testament. God, the creator of all things, decides to become human. He enters this world by overshadowing an unmarried teenage woman, is born in the poorest, lowliest of circumstances, lives a life of poverty till he reaches the age of 30, and then he calls unto him fishermen, tax collectors, prostitutes to be his core followers. He was arrested. His followers abandoned him and denied him after witnessing incredible, miraculous signs and wonders. Then he is crucified. Now, Roman crucifixion wasn't not only one of the most painful ways of dying. Roman crucifixion was a way that they sent a message. To everyone and anyone who's seen this, it was a sign of ultimate humiliation. Anyone that was crucified was seen as the lowest of the low. It showed the world who was really in charge here. 1 Corinthians 23, we preach Christ crucified, which is a stumbling block for the Jew and foolishness to the Gentile. For the Jew, the Messiah was supposed to defeat the Romans and lead an exodus of sorts. His crucifixion defined him as a contemptible outcast. For the non-Jews, his crucifixion showed him as a contemptible outcast. I mean, what does a poor crucified Jew in Israel have anything to do with a rich businessman in Greece, right? Their attitude is vividly illustrated by a well-documented piece of graffiti that was actually found on a wall, and you can find this anywhere around Rome, AD 200. It shows a man raising his hands in prayer to a crucified man with the head of a donkey, and the caption reads, "Alexamenos worships his God." We're not sure who exactly Alexamenos was, but he was believed to be a very popular Roman at the time, that was a notable Christian. To the Gentiles, they found it utterly unimaginable that these Christians would place a crucified, contemptible criminal on the throne of the highest position of the universe. This attitude continues to this day. On paper, to the world, all this seems too much to believe, too fantastic and absurd. Why would God operate in this way? Let's look a little closer now at Corinthians 1:18 through 31. I got a couple of lengthy Bible verses here, so bear with me. "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, 'I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate.' Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Through it was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jew and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jew and Greek, Christ is the power of God and wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you first were called. Not many of you were influential. Not many of you were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of this world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly and despised things of this world. He chose the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, 'Let the one who boasts boast in the Lord.'" So my question now is that I have now, what am I missing? What did I leave out when I listed all the shortcomings of those names of the ancients earlier on? What is the key ingredient that brings all of this foolishness together? What that explains how God used the imperfect people and unseemly circumstances to accomplish his goals? And number two is, how does this apply to me, to us as a body of church, and what is our excuse for not living out our calling to the fullest? So I have one more long verse to read to you guys, and it's turned to Hebrews 11 for the answer to answer these questions. "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what is visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke of all of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. And for before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about the things that not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness that is keeping with faith." And I just want to stop there just for a second and we'll move on. But I just kind of put yourself in Noah's shoes for a second. Imagine that you've given this great responsibility to preach to the world that, you know, what's coming here. And you get out there and you preach for 120 years and you don't gain a single convert. I mean, that could be pretty discouraging. Am I right? Yeah. I mean, look at the rest of us. If we don't get enough likes on a Facebook post, we're getting discouraged, right? So I just, but the key word there is that it wasn't up to Noah to do the saving. That's God's job. Noah's job was to be obedient. And through his obedience, through his faith, his walk, he was able to save his family. And if we can save our own family, isn't that a good place to start, right? Back to Hebrews 1:8. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would rather receive as his inheritance, go to the place he would later receive as an inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land. Like a stranger in a foreign country, he lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who both were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city of foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was unable to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and countless as the sands on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things that were promised to them. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of a country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. And by faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him that is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead. And so in a matter of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshipped as he leaned on his staff. By faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites and gave instructions as regarding to his bones. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child and that they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of the Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as a greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the application of the blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not reach the firstborn of Israel. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the army marched around them for 7 days. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she was welcomed to spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith conquered kingdoms and ministered justice and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions and quenched the fury of the flames, escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed armies. Women received their dead and were raised back to life. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword and they went about in sheepskin and goatskins, poor, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in the desert and mountains, living in caves and holes in the ground. They were all commended for their faith, yet none received what they had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Faith is the key. Without it, all of this is foolishness. Faith is what removes the scales from our eyelids so that we can make sense of all this, that it all rings true to us. One of the things I found interesting is, what did the Hebrew writer, the writers of Hebrew, the Hebrews, leave out in that long declaration of the Hall of Faith there. What he left out is he left out all those shortcomings that I was talking about earlier. All those failings and shortcomings that I mentioned, they are remembered for their faith and that they walk with God, right? So God does not necessarily call the qualified and the perfect. He does three things for the ones he calls. He equips them. He does the work for us. He gives them a helper. So how does this apply to me and to us? And what responsibility does this faith require from me? Matthew 28:19-20. These are shorter, I promise. Jesus says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teach them to obey everything I command you. Surely I am with you always until the very end of the age." And then the next thing, 1 Peter 4:10 says, "Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms." So we are called to obey, we are called to make disciples, and we are called to serve with the gifts that we've been given. What stops us from really leaning into these requirements that God has put before us? Busyness, lack of faith, lack of confidence, self-doubt. I could never do that. Who would listen to me? Please, Lord, send someone else. Speak or pray in front of an audience or in front of strangers? I'd be horrified. I could never do that. Please, Lord, send somebody else. I don't feel right pushing my beliefs on someone else, especially maybe a coworker or somebody. How can I push my beliefs on them? You know, what right do I have? Please, Lord, send somebody else. There's so many others that are better at that than I am. I'm not qualified. Please, Lord, send somebody else. Sounds like somebody else we just read about, right? Moses had all the same excuses. We all have similar obstacles in our life. I've really struggled with those, especially with those in authority over me at work. I mean, how am I supposed to talk to someone that has authority over me about where they're going to spend their eternity? It's always been awkward for me. And I always struggle again. I get up here and I struggle. You know, like, who am I to get up and give a message? You know, but we just do. But the word tells us, "For he hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the mighty." He equips us, he does the work for us, and he sends us a helper. For Moses, he gave him a staff to show signs and miracles that God was with him. God performed the miracles and the plagues as the signs for Moses. Then he also gave him Aaron. When Moses felt unqualified, unworthy, and unable to speak, God provided a helper for him. David had Jonathan. Elijah had Elisha. Jeremiah had Baruch. Today, he equips us by speaking to us through his word and has sent the Holy Spirit as our helper. Through these, we are fully equipped to carry out the mission that he has given us. Every Christian has a part to play and a role to serve. It may not be to preach. It may not be to be a foreign missionary. But we must pray daily for God to use us in a way that he sees fit. We must find in him the courage to do what he's asking of us. And what is he asking of us? Well, just like before, obey his commandments, make disciples, and to use our talents to serve. We first must realize that we don't have to reach a certain level of Christian perfection to serve. You don't have to be a black belt in Christian theology to serve. At this point, I want to use this time for a quick little demonstration, so I was going to ask Josh and Kyle to come up. I'm going to make a little room for them. So, real quickly, these guys were messing around in men's group a little bit. And Kyle was flipping Josh up in the air like a pizza. And I said, I got to use that in a sermon sometime. So go ahead, guys. That's a good dad. So thank you, guys. Real quick, Kyle. So, Kyle, are you a black belt in jiu-jitsu?
I am the lowest belt that you can get.
Well, say, the point of the story is that you don't have to be a black belt to teach some sound fundamentals of self-defense, just like you don't have to be a black belt or a 30-year Christian to be able to serve, to be able to reach out to somebody that's hurting or lost, right? Thank you, guys. It kind of made me think about, where's Bob Blaylock? Bob. Bob was telling a little story in church. Bob, what did you do, like you were saved, and then, like, within 2 days, what were you doing? Well, it was amazing that Bob receives the gospel, doesn't know anything about it really, anything about the Bible really. He heard the gospel, the words convicted him, was convinced to be he didn't know how to share those things, but he was convinced that and gave his life over to Christ. And within 2 days, he's out knocking on doors to share the gospel with strangers, right? And he shared with us. He said he was sitting up there knocking on the door, just praying, God, please don't let anybody answer the door. You know, he was already praying. So let me get back where I was here. To me, it is, you don't have to start big. You know, you don't have to start with, when Jesus first approached Peter, he didn't say, hey, Peter, walk out onto that water there and throw that net out there and get yourself a haul of fish and come back to the boat. You know, Peter's faith was pretty small at that point. You know, it was all he could do to throw that net right back out there at the end of the boat. It wasn't until later that his faith was encouraged, his faith was deepened, that he was able to have the Lord call him out to walk on the water with him. So the key is to start small. Let God instruct and equip you by studying the Word daily. Get involved in a study group. Surround yourself with people that will encourage you and pray for you. And we have a great men's group. As you see here, we have a great men's group that meets every Wednesday night at 7. Thank you, Brian and Larry, for hosting that. You guys can come around and wrestle with Josh, Seth, and Kyle there. And by the way, there, if your men's group isn't practicing arm bars and choke holds, are you really in a men's group, right? Next is, look for ways that you can get involved here at our church, right? And look around our church. We really struggle sometimes with volunteerism. I mean, there are many needs here, and the work a lot of times goes to the few. The Apostle Paul did leave us some instruction on how our walk with Christ and how our service in the church should look. And mine kind of looks like this right now. Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. And Christ, Paul, and there's me, you know. That's what kind of my life looks at this point, but I'm trying, I'm learning. You know, but I figured out that there is a cure. And that cure is that maybe we need to be a little more Amish, okay, or almost-ish, so to speak, right? So I was watching a video. I think you guys can pull that video up. And so they had the foundation up, and they're just going to town here. It looks like a swarm of bees up here. This is 10 hours, okay? This is a period of 10 hours. Look how big that barn is. So, I'm just thinking what could have been done, right? All the guys that did all this work. Well, I'll just kind of, as that's fading out, just think about that. This is the power of coming together as a body right here. They know what they're doing. Think of what our church would look like if we all just did a little like that, if everybody gave a little, right? So I was thinking about this, and it's like there's so many areas in our church that need some help and that could just use a little. And if we all just kind of did this, it would be so much easier. I have been the elder overseer for children's ministries for 6-7 months now. I've done nothing. This is the first time I've really mentioned it. What have I did? I have a granddaughter that's in children's ministry back there, and she enjoys that. We have so many kids here, which is great, which is the future of our church. But unfortunately, the work is often less left to the few. And I know that can be discouraging to the people that are in there week after week doing that good work. And so my wife and I decided that, we need to step up. We got a grandchild in ministry. it's time for us to do something. So we're going to put ourselves on the rotation, you know, as an example of, you know, getting involved and doing more. And, I mean, we have security ministries, we have construction, groundskeeping, you know, we really need help in every way. So I just would think about if you can see a need, if you feel a need, you feel God tugging on your heart, pray about that, you know, that we can really use the help there. And don't worry if you're qualified. God doesn't call the qualified. He equips the called, right? So I'd like you to all stand with me as we're wrapping up here. I'm going to play an oldie but a goodie song here. This is from this is a youth group throwback song. I think it kind of matches our call that we have today for volunteerism and getting involved with the church. And so some of you may have heard it. Some of it will be new, but go ahead. Hopefully. Anybody got any good dad jokes? With our eyes closed, I would like all of us to just search our hearts. Have I really gone all in on what God has called me to do? Could I be learning more, studying more, doing more? God, is there anything that you're calling me to do? Where do you want me, Lord, and how can I serve? I just wish that all of us would just meditate on this as we close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for choosing the foolish things of this world to accomplish your will. If we boast in anything, may it be the Lord. Lord, help us to set aside all of our worries, all of our fears and doubts that you may use us. We cannot do any of these things on our own, but on our own strength, but do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Fill us with your Spirit and equip us to do with your strength so that we may go where you want us to go, do what you want us to do, say what you want us to say, and serve how would you want us to serve. Let us truly be your hands and feet, Lord. We thank you and we praise the name of Jesus. Amen.